Interested in learning about wine, but not sure where to start? You're in the right place. Welcome to the Cork and Fizz Guide to Wine podcast. I'm your host, Haley Bowman, and I'm so glad you're here. I'm a wine enthusiast turned wine educator and founder of the Seattle-based wine tasting business, Cork and Fizz. It is my goal to build your confidence in wine by making it approachable and lots of fun. You can expect to learn everything from how to describe your favorite wine to what to pair with dinner tonight and so much more. Whether you're a casual wine sipper or a total cork dork like myself, this podcast is for you. So grab yourself a glass and let's dive in. For today's episode, I am so excited to introduce you to the husband and wife team of Jayme Henderson and Steve Steese, founders and winemakers of the Storm Cellar in the state of Colorado. Yes, I said Colorado. We're talking to Colorado winemakers. How cool is that? The Storm Cellar is a boutique winery located in Hotchkiss, Colorado, specializing in high-quality aromatic white and rosé wine. It all started in 2017 after years within the Denver culinary industry. Jayme and Steve left their positions as sommeliers, purchased a neglected vineyard property in a stunning location at nearly 6,000 feet above sea level, and started their new lives on Colorado's western slope. The two of them live, manage, and share every aspect of life and work on the vineyard property. They are the vineyard and property managers, the project planners and coordinators, the winemakers, the marketing social media directors, the delivery drivers, the phone answers, and the bookkeepers. Anything you can think of, they are doing it for the Storm Cellar. Their goal at the Storm Cellar is to showcase the attributes of their unique alpine-desert terroir, bring the West Elks AVA into the national wine spotlight, and become a premier destination for an elevated Colorado wine experience. Now, before we get into the interview, I want to share a quick reminder. If you are not on my mailing list yet, I would so love for you to join. When you do, you will get a free shopping guide that has 15 of my favorite wines under $15. Just head to corkandfizz.com, scroll all the way down to the bottom, and there'll be a section where you can join the mailing list. I send out a weekly newsletter. It's filled with wine tips, recommendations, special offers, things to learn, and so much more. And if you'd like to drink wine with me or with amazing winemakers, come join my virtual tasting club, The Cork Crew. After this podcast interview, a couple weeks later, we actually had Jayme and Steve in The Cork Crew, and they told us all about their wine, and everybody got to ask a ton of questions. It was so much fun. So this is your opportunity to taste wine with me and learn, along with learning from other people in the wine world, including winemakers, sommeliers, authors, and so much more. Want to give it a try without the commitment? You're in luck. Right now, I'm offering a free class pass to anyone who wants to try out the Cork Crew. With this pass, you will be able to join a Cork Crew event of your choosing. No strings attached. I don't need your credit card. I don't need you to make an account. All I need is your email. You will be my guest. So simply head to corkandfizz.com/free class pass to get your class pass. All right, without further ado, let's get into this interview. Hello, it's nice to finally see you, even if just virtually after chatting so much. I'm so excited to have you here.
It's nice to meet you, Haley. Thank you.
Nice to be here.
Yeah, super excited to have you here. I always like to kind of just start off. I do a little intro for you, but I think you guys say your story the best. So do you want to say a little bit about who you are and what you do?
Sure. Yeah. I'm Jayme. This is my husband, Steve Steese. The two of us own and operate a winery out here in Colorado, and it's called the Storm Cellar. That's the name of our project. And we both farm we manage 23 acres that are fenced in, but we have 8 acres of producing vines and 8 acres of Riesling here too. So specialize in white and rosé winemaking, and that's what we love. I'll let Steve talk too.
Yeah, we're all of it. Whatever the Storm Cellar is, it's the two of us. So
yeah,
we do farming, winemaking, label design, social media, tastings, deliveries.
It's not necessarily going to stay like that forever, but it's where we are right now.
So, where you got to start, right? And it's that you know how everything works, right? It's easier to then tell people how to do the work afterwards.
That's a big part. You know, yeah. How do you train somebody if you've never done it yourself? Exactly.
Yeah, exactly. And it's so impressive. So I think it's always fun to find out, you know, wine, I feel like always like brings people in unique ways. And so I'd love to know for each of you, what sparked your interest in wine?
You can go first on that one. You have a colorful story, I'll admit.
Sure. It was Italy for me that really was the first spark for me. I was living in Fortona, sort of eastern Tuscany area. If you ever saw the movie Under the Tuscan Sun, literally filmed while I was living there. Pretty cool. And it's hard to not fall in love with wine in that moment. And that was the spark. But I mean, it was really restaurant life and high-end restaurants that really fueled long-term my love of wine. That's where we really cut our teeth, was in restaurants for sure.
Yeah, for me, I worked at a restaurant when I was in college, and the first wine that I ever had, like when I went out to dinner, I remember it was Gabbiano Chianti Classico. It was top level fancy for me. And I never discount where a person starts, be it with like Black Box, Yellowtail, and not that Gabbiano was anything like that, but like, that was what really got me started. And I moved out here to Colorado and was kind of in between jobs and worked at a restaurant. That's where Steve and I met. And that's where we got to know that we could work well together, you know, and a lot of people can't do that. A lot of people say, don't work with your partner. It can work, but yeah, just, we decided to sign up for sommelier certification in 2009. And both of us went separate directions in the same city in Denver with our SOM certification, eventually writing wine lists and curating beverage lists. And that was so much fun. It was definitely, it started us on our journey toward what we do now, even though it's a complete 180 from what we do now.
Yeah. Same industry, different life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did you always know you would be in wine? Did you have any career before wine?
We did not. I mean, I grew up like in a household that did not drink. My dad did and my mom didn't. Neither of us had a taste of alcohol until we were 21. And then we definitely like caught up quickly. It was honestly, like, I was in the teaching profession and I still utilize that skill set today, but I was looking toward being a psychologist. I wanted to work with children. And then I bounced around and studied pattern design and then took the LSAT. I was all over the place.
Oh my gosh.
I decided to work in the restaurant industry to kind of find myself, and inadvertently and happily found my life with wine. Just out of curiosity, I was kind of pursuing what family wanted me to be, what I thought I was supposed to be. And like, I always admire people that just jump in and they know right away in their early 20s. I did not, but I love the journey that I had. If I didn't have that, maybe I wouldn't be, you know, in the position that I am today or the profession I'm in today.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I find it's very common. There are very few people I find that, like, you know, go straight from schooling and then into the wine world, right? It's like, it's generally like you were almost like just in a waiting zone and wine came to you and you were like, oh, okay, yeah, this is cool. Let's try this.
No, that's well said. The waiting room analogy is perfect. Yeah.
All right. So it sounds like some restaurant experience is kind of maybe where the wine started. Can you take us through kind of the story from there to then buying the vineyard and starting the Storm Cellar?
I know I just answered the question, but I have to say this because ultimately it's both of our fault, but it was definitely like my fault. Sometimes I really say I regret doing what I did. So back in 2016, when we were still buying wine for the restaurant that we worked at, we went on a wine buying trip to Sonoma and we were at Peter Michael Winery and we had done some wine dinners with their wines, loved their Pinots and Chards. And actually Sir Peter Michael of Peter Michael Winery asked me at a table in front of a lot of other beverage professionals, like, what's happening in the Colorado wine scene? And embarrassingly, neither of us really knew what was happening. We curated a wine list of over 750 bottles, and the three Colorado wines that we had on the list, we didn't even put on the list. So it was our mission to go back and kind of discover what is in our backyard. And how it started succinctly is that I went home while Steve was working one night. We were working at that same restaurant And I did an internet search about Colorado wine and then had a harebrained idea to look at Colorado vineyards for sale and said, we should buy this. I sent Steve a link to this vineyard site that we ended up not buying. Long story short, we made a trip out here. We booked an Airbnb. 2 weeks later, went to this wine region, the West Elks AVA, that we have never been to before. And it was, we can elaborate on that later, but that's how it happened. It started with just like, we should buy this. We were not financially ready to do it. It was a crazy idea, but we were ready for a life change. And I think when you're desperate for a life change, you can really make allowances to make it happen and things will line up.
Yeah. It was fortuitous timing. It came together so fast. And literally when we...
Under a year.
We bought the property in March and the vines were already breaking bud that first year. So it was literally like rolled right into this. It was a
not prepared
frantic transition for sure.
So yeah, you transitioned to that. So you bought it, the vines are already budding. And so did you do the whole process that first year, like, you know, growing the grapes, making the wine, creating the storm cellar, or where did it start?
We did a piece of what you just said there. So when we bought this property, it was only a farm. Mm-hmm. It was only a vineyard. There was zero winemaking going on here. It was actually owned by another winery in Colorado's other AVA, which is a little over an hour away from here. This was like an external vineyard of theirs. So they would farm here, tote the grapes back. All the processing was done there. So the first year, all we did was farm. It was too fast for us to make the transition into farming and winemaking. It was a big enough transition just to transition into farming.
And but we didn't have any equipment for winemaking.
But then the second year we were here, that was our first vintage.
I think that sounds fast. Like the fact that you did it your fast. Second year.
Our equipment was literally showing up on trucks. Like it was being pulled off and being put into production like immediately that day.
It was a last minute race to the finish line.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Okay. So, I mean, I have to admit, I've never tried Colorado wine and I'm very excited to try yours. It's on its way. I think UPS just told me like it's coming tonight. I'll be picking it up, but it'll be just in time for us doing the court crew tasting later this month. Will be super fun. But I'd love to learn more about this. I didn't even realize there were AVAs in Colorado. Like I kind of just thought it was just, you know, you're making wine. Every state makes wine, right? But not every state has an AVA. And so for those listening, AVA is basically American Viticultural Area. It's essentially like a defined wine growing region meant to be like the wines from this region have a particular thing about them that is special or this region does something. So can you talk a little bit more about the West Elks AVA? You know, what makes it great for growing wine and what kind of challenges you face in that area?
Yeah. Oh, so we can look across from where we're filming right now. We're in the heart of the West Elks AVA. Like Steve said a moment ago, two AVAs recognized in our state. The larger of the two is Grand Valley. So a lot of people know where Grand Junction is. It's on the western border, like you're going to Utah. So if you think about the state of Colorado, you've got the Rocky Mountains, that continental divide, and you've got Denver on the east side, and that's known as the Front Range. And then you've got the western slope. And the western slope is obviously, it's less populated, not very many major cities, Grand Junction being the most major city. And we're about an hour and a half kind of south and east of Grand Junction. We're a much smaller AVA. We have 10 active wineries on our wine trail, two cideries. And it's an emerging region. We're predominantly driven by summer tourism. So a lot of people come through to go from like May through October, and that is the intensity of our season. It's also the growing time of our season, the time where we're a white and rosé winery. It's the time when our wines are very popular because it's a little bit more, you know, it's hotter outside. So it's our busy season. This is our slow season, rebuilding, recuperating. But as far as like the, and I'll let Steve kind of weigh in on this too, but we look outside and we're about 6,000 feet above sea level. So for growing grapes, it is, like you said, it is rewarding and challenging. The challenge lies with the fact that we're so vulnerable to late spring frosts, early fall frosts. And I remember reading about zones like that in textbooks or when I was, you know, studying for, you know, any SOM certification. You know, it makes sense, but when you're riding the wave of that, you can lose your entire vintage, which we have within the 7 years that we've been out here. the entire AVA lost all of its vines. We had to cut them down to the base and regrow them. So it is a wild ride. I don't want to offend any other winemaking region, but it is very hard to grow grapes in Colorado. And yeah.
Yeah, it's the fringe of where you can pull it off.
Yeah.
Really. And our valley, you know, we reference it for kind of the wine geeks crowd to regions in California. There are, you know, north to south mountain ranges in California that are broken throughout California with east to west valleys. Mm-hmm. And those are a lot of California's great cool climate grape growing regions, because what's happening there is those valleys are siphoning in cool air from the Pacific mm-hmm. to cool off what would normally be hot California, where we're in an east to west valley, but it is pulling in heat from the desert to the west. So we are warmer than we should be. So yeah. It's doing the exact same thing, just in a reverse effect as it would in California. Because if you look at the climate map on any given day around here, our valley is a couple degrees, if not 5 or more degrees warmer than every other place around us. It's mm-hmm. this cool little microclimate right in this valley here.
Oh, that's so cool.
And cool, that word, a lot of people think Colorado, they think cold. It's a cool climate. We grow Pinot Noir, we grow Chardonnay and Riesling. Those are, you know, typically cool climate growing region grapes. And we'll get temperatures in the 90s. We didn't break 100 this year, but aside from it, we're not necessarily a cool climate growing region. It is a compact growing region. So we have this very narrow window so we're limited by the grape varieties that we can grow, because we need to have them break bud after that frost event, but we need them to start early enough so that they'll ripen in time.
Yeah, absolutely. So it more has to do with you need grapes that ripen. Yeah, you only have a short amount of time to, you know, let the grapes do their thing. And it's so interesting. Because that was my thing. I was like, Colorado, I think cold, right? Like,
yeah.
When you're talking about the vines, I'm curious. So when I went out to Walla Walla here in Eastern Washington, which is typically warm, but in the winters can get quite cold.
Yes.
And it was interesting that I was talking to one of the winemakers who actually takes care of the vineyard as well. And they've actually come up with a way to save the vines every year. Because what would happen is they would only bury one of they have the tea or whatnot for the vines, right? And then they take one of those arms and bury it so that in case the rest of the, you know, vine died, they could bring that one up and then that one would start off their new thing. And it's interesting. They actually came up with a new way of doing it because they were sick of always starting with this one arm all the time. They had to do it 3 or 4 times in a span of 10 years. And so they ended up coming up with a way of doing the goblets, the tall goblet training, but they brought it down low. So it's low to the ground, these goblets, and then they bury the whole thing over the winter. So I was just curious, have you guys tried anything with how to help the vines survive over the cold?
Yes. It's
challenging here.
It is. So I'll preface it because we do have, so Colorado thought it was absolutely impervious to the destruction of Phylloxera. It hadn't visited our state, and we thought we were scot-free because of our soil pH, because of our cold winters. And that was the downfall, to think that anything remains static within the farming aspect. Phylloxera was discovered in Colorado in 2016. It was definitely here before then, probably brought in by contaminated nursery plants, you know, dormant.
Sure.
And we saw the vineyard before we purchased it. We looked at it in 2016. It was thriving. We saw harvest videos. We saw actual clusters. We walked the entire vineyard. That said, we discovered Phylloxera about 4 months after we closed on the property here. And so it does relate to vine protection. We're in the process of completely replanting our vineyard. And so you have two options when you have Phylloxera in your vineyard. You can plant cold hardy French American hybrid grape varieties, which can absolutely withstand temps down to 30 below zero. You can also, if you want to have that vinifera, that, you know, European variety, you have to plant on grafted vines. And so right now, half of our vineyard is own rooted, non-grafted, completely susceptible to Phylloxera. Those are sturdier vines because they don't have a graft line. The graft line is the most, you know, susceptible to cold weather portion of the plant. So it's all of those vines that we had planted, both the own rooted and also the grafted in that 2020 frost, that put everything down to the ground. The ones that had that deeper root system that weren't grafted, they came up prolifically. So they are a little stronger. As far as protecting them, right now we have to hill up or cover our graft lines. And so we have about 8,000 that we've planted by hand, and we don't have a crew out here. It's very multifaceted in Colorado as far as like what we have to work with. So we'll cover up by whatever means that we find. Each year we're more and more efficient, but you have to cover up that graft line. But you're right. You could totally lose that trellising system, that T, that portion where it has, you know, the trunk and then those cordons. And you would have to cut back to just above that graft line and wait for something to come up. We do save a couple of those long, you know, shoots that are canes in case the plant doesn't make it. And then we have something to work with the next year. So
okay. We're
constantly learning.
Yeah. Yeah.
No,
I love it. Just for the phylloxera, I think anybody who's listened to me knows I talk about phylloxera all the time, you know, because it's so important. And I mean, it's had such an impact on, but for anybody who hasn't heard, phylloxera is like, it's this tiny little like aphid like insect that basically destroys the grapevines. It started here in America and it was brought over to Europe and destroyed their vines. But our American rootstock, which is not what you make most wine out of, is, you know, that's not susceptible to it. So that you can protect against. But the problem is that you have American grapes that don't necessarily make always the best wine, though I'm excited to talk about the hybrids in a little bit here so we can hear more about those. So you can graft a French vine on it and make your typical, or any type of vine, I should say, any European vine on it and make a regular European grape, or you can do the hybrid, which we'll talk about in a little bit. But before we get into that, I just had one other question kind of with respect to the AVA. Did you ever consider making wine anywhere else other than in the West Elks AVA?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Was it always Colorado or was
no.
it?
No. It was,
was never Colorado until that question was asked in 2016 and we started taking a deep dive. But
yeah, Jayme had done a bunch of harvests in Willamette and we had eyes on a really cool piece of property there that wasn't a vineyard. It was more like a wine shop kind of thing. We didn't. So Jayme has an online presence where she does a lot of cocktail development. I honestly thought it was going to be more of like a wine and cocktail bar in Denver for a long time. I thought that was going to be the next thing. Mm-hmm. I didn't see vineyard owner coming. I didn't.
No, we both gardened. And then that's where we're like, okay, we can scale this up.
I was like, you have to have some experience, right? Like that'd be like terrifying walking yes. into like a vineyard with like, I do not have a green thumb at all. I'd know nothing about it. So at least you had a little experience. Yeah, exactly. Yes. Oh, fun. I love it. No, it is always fun where you end up. And you never know. You might end up, you know, trying, you know, those other things as well or as you go. And it's always fun. Just wine is never ending. I think there's always so many opportunities.
That's the exciting part about it.
Multifaceted for sure.
Yeah.
Okay. So we talked about your wines. You mentioned earlier that you make white and rosé wines. I think you've kind of already talked about this a little bit, but I just wanted to ask why no red, I guess, or why focus on the white and the rosé?
Yeah. A
couple reasons.
We get that question.
Yeah.
There were some funny moments where, you know, we had said something to some guests in a tasting room and it came back to us from another winery. Like, we heard you say that this place wasn't good for making red wines. And I'm like, no. That's not what we said. Well, it's funny how things get around.
Oh, yes.
At the core, I would say it's because that's what we like to drink more than any other reason.
And the core that this particular vineyard was planted to white varieties. It was also planted to Pinot Gris, a little bit of Pinot Noir. So I have to say that too. It's a combination.
Yeah. But as far as this region and what it does, we were talking about it earlier, being at basically 6,000 feet, compact growing season. Like Jamie was saying, it does get plenty hot here during the day. Mm-hmm. But what is the saving grace is that elevation means it always cools down at night. It's the diurnal shift, the same things that happens. That's how you preserve finesse and most importantly, acidity in wine. So the wines grown at this kind of elevation will almost always have a pronounced natural acidity. Mm-hmm. Well, what kind of wines do people tend to like pronounced natural acidity in? You know, it's not very often where people say like, that was a delicious acidic Cabernet. Like that phrase doesn't like roll off of people's tongues. Yeah. But, you know, Pinot Noir, of course, you know, if you could get it right, but grape like Nebbiolo, there's a vineyard, vineyard here that has Nebbiolo planted that will never get ripe. Because our season is too short for Nebbiolo, unfortunately. Sure.
It's trial and error. It's the Wild West.
Yeah.
But it is being more directed at this point too. So,
yeah. So, you know, other things, you can harvest your grapes earlier for whites and rosés than you could for necessarily getting them, which can save you if cold temperatures are coming, which is a lot of the reason why we're nudging towards sparkling, because sparkling you harvest even weeks earlier than you would for a normal dry.
That was honestly one of my questions. I can kind of see as you talk about the AVA and why like white and rosé just kind of fit that area a little bit better and like the red, but then that made me curious. I was like, so is sparkling going to happen? Is that something that is on the, yeah.
Yes. I'm super excited about that. It's both of us. It's our favorite wine style. And even like right when we went out here, we're like, we want to make sparkling wine. Of course, we were saying that without knowing the labor, the cost, the storage, the equipment that you'd need to do like a traditional method. And that's the method that we wanted to do. So finally in 2022, we decided, or nature decided for us, to make a sparkling wine. We had a bear invade our vineyard, two bears. They were prolific in the valley, and they're the sweetest, obviously they can be territorial and rough, but they're just, you know, they're part of nature, but they don't really reside in our valley. They're up in the high country. That particular year, their food source was depleted because of a fall frost. So they came down. And you kind of think like they're never going to eat these highly acidic Riesling grapes. Well, they did. So we looked and they were decimating the vineyard. And so we took a Brix measurement, and it was perfectly timed for sparkling wine. So we brought in the grapes the very next day. And so a bear was the catalyst.
So this name is going to be named. The bear is going to somehow fit into the name of this wine, right?
Because we did think about that.
Like, you live in Washington. And so like, you know, Kyle MacLachlan, the actor, his project is like pursued by a bear. And I was like, man, he nailed it. But I'm like, it really did happen to us. I didn't want to step on his toes or his bear's toes.
No, that's fair. Wow. That is something like when you think of all the things you need to protect your vineyard against, I mean, animals is one of them, but a bear?
We did not see that coming. So it definitely like whipped us into shape, and we, you know, ended up taking the plunge and making it that year. No regrets.
Oh my gosh. So cool. Okay. So fun. I'm really excited to see that one when it comes out.
Do you ever feel like you're stuck in a rut doing the same old thing day in and day out? You wake up, go to work, come home, go to bed, and repeat. When life gets busy, it can be easy to fall into that routine and forget how important it is to prioritize joy and fun. But what if I told you there is a way to break out of that cycle? A way to bring more excitement and adventure into your life. And it involves one of the most wonderful things in the world, wine. Introducing my Cork Crew Virtual Tasting Club. This is not your ordinary wine club. This is a community of people who are passionate about exploring new flavors, learning about different wine styles, and having fun along the way. Each month, we'll select two styles of wine to focus on. We'll taste them together virtually, all while learning more about the regions that the wines are from and the grapes that make the wine. You'll also have the opportunity to meet winemakers, sommeliers, and other wine professionals through our monthly community events. But it's not just about the wine. It's about breaking out of your routine, trying new things, and having a little fun. Imagine being able to impress your friends at your next dinner party with your newfound wine knowledge. Feeling confident when you walk into a wine shop, knowing exactly what to look for and what you'll enjoy. Imagine adding a little bit of excitement to your everyday life. So why not do something for you? Come join the Cork Crew Virtual Tasting Club and start exploring the endless sea of discovery and joy that is the world of wine. Sign up at my website, corkandfizz.com/thecorkcrew, and don't forget to use code WINE101 to get your first month free. And now, back to the show.
Let's dive into talking a little bit about the hybrid grape. So I kind of started to give a little intro to that. For those that aren't familiar, so most wine we make out of this species of grape from Europe, except there are lots of different species of grapes. And then there are some specifically here in America, like our, that make the Concord grape juice, right? That's our Vitis labrusca versus Vitis vinifera. And so a hybrid is where it's an offspring of two different vines, usually Vitis vinifera and then something else. And here in America, it might be any of the ones that exist here. And so you guys make wine out of both some of the European varietals, but then also the hybrids. So what is your approach to these hybrid grapes? Do you do anything different like in the winemaking process versus the European grapes?
Yes. And I will say
they're different. They are different to work with. They are.
And honestly, they do different things to our winemaking style. It's we really, you know, like so many winemakers, really try to make wines that reflect what's happening in the vintage, what's happening in that particular grape. And I'm looking across because we have a bottle of it right here. As far as working with hybrid varieties, a lot of times they cannot have a lot of complexity. And that's mainly, I don't want to say mainly, sometimes it's because maybe that they lack tannic structure, that they're just a little bit more fruit forward. They can have different characteristics. I think you alluded to that a little earlier, that might not be for the traditional palate. Some can flat out be a little weird and funky. I think that we're really embracing as a winemaking palate or a wine enjoying palate, kind of the differences that these grapes can yield. However, I don't know, we've tasted a lot of high quality, low quality hybrid wines, seen some great expressions, enough for us to say, let's give it a try. We've narrowed it down to where we like working with St. Vincent, Chamberson. We're working with Itasca, but they're usually a little bit higher, not a little, a lot higher in acid. And so when you're like making the wine, you're waiting for this acid to drop because it's almost too high. It'd be like a tart lemon and it would be an imbalanced wine. But at the same time, your sugar levels are getting high. So normally you have this balanced, like sugar levels are rising, acid levels are falling. And so you get this perfectly timed portion of time to pick this grape and to make a wine that's balanced. And you really don't get that with hybrids very often. It's a bumpy ride and you really are battling those high acid. Yeah.
Yeah. Screaming natural acidity. A lot of these grape varieties, they can stand, like Jayme was saying, temperatures down to 30 below zero. So they're grapes that'll be grown in a place like, you know, Minnesota, and they can stand it there, but they get even less ripe than they do here. So the acid, numbers in those kind of places at harvest is so high that the only way to balance it out is to leave residual sugar. So a lot of people's introductions to hybrid wines are off dry or semi-sweet versions of wines, because if you've got 15 or 20 grams of TA, you can't drink that in a dry wine. You just can't drink that.
Sure.
It's interesting. They're different numbers to work with as far as the chemistry, for sure. Very different numbers.
Yeah.
They get some weird aromas. And you were asking, how do we handle
it? They also get some great aromas.
So we work with two red hybrid varieties, like Jayme said, St. Vincent and Chamberson. And extended maceration on either of those two wines with the skins can lead to some kind of funky things. We've tried some kind of funky versions of both those. So we basically whole cluster press both of those. So we skip skin contact almost altogether. Maybe it gets an hour. Sometimes we'll do a tiny little bit for complexity, but not enough to really pull that out. So we use them in rosé production is what we're using them for, because they have amazing natural color and super intense flavor.
Yeah, that color is beautiful. I mean, it's so bright. Yeah.
Yeah.
So to get that color, like say with like Pinot Noir, really thin skin, but even like Syrah or something like that, you would have to take a long, you know, time of maceration to get that color. This was direct to press. Like Steve said, we just whole cluster pressed it. And the juice that comes out when you press it is just bright magenta. Really?
Is the juice inside that color, or is that just from that little bit of skin contact?
That's a great question. It is the juice inside. So it's, I'm sure you've heard the classification of a Tinturier grape. It's that particular grape falls in like 1% of all red wines for winemaking, where the juice is actually already.
Oh, it's the exception to that rule. When I tell everybody, when I'm always like, okay, when you make a red wine and you press the grapes and you get the juice, it looks like a white wine. It doesn't get red until you put the skin in contact with it. But this one, it's like one of those where like anything you say in wine, There is always an exception.
Oh, yes.
This is the exception.
Yeah. It's a tiny number, though. I mean, like two dozen varieties out of three or 4,000 red varieties. And a handful of those are the hybrid varieties, Marquette, Chamberson.
St. Vincent's.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So. Yep.
Interesting. Okay, cool. I always love it. And I think, like, in my mind, I feel like the best hybrid wines are those that are treated differently. Like, you really just have to, like, accept that, like, this is not the same thing. We're not going to make it exactly the same way that we would a European variety. You have to kind of learn what it wants to do. There's a great, I'm from Wisconsin originally, and just literally the town over, it wasn't there when I was growing up, but when I went back home to visit family, there is a winery that was started by this woman that grew up in Wisconsin as well, that does all hybrid grapes. And those are definitely some of the best that I've tried as well, because she focuses in on and hones in on the hybrid and learns what to do with it. So it's really fun hearing you guys talk and say, like, how different it ends up being working with a hybrid versus, you know, the European style.
Definitely.
Yeah, we're also unabashed blenders too.
I was just going to go there.
We have never released, I mean, of all the hybrid variety wines, it's never been 100% of that.
And we're open with that. And of course, we varietally label. It says Rosé of St. Vincent. But we do disclose, like, some years, maybe the aromatics in that particular wine from that vintage, which it's been different every single year. Very many reasons, but we'll add a little, say, Gewurztraminer to add a floral lift, or if it's lacking texture, if we have a great Viognier, to give it just a little roundness on the palate, not to take away its varietal characteristics, but to enhance it. I always like to liken it as building a cocktail, or, you know, getting that perfect dish where you need that squeeze of lemon, that pinch of salt, that savory note, that touch of, like, hot honey or whatever it is when you're trying to bring balance. You think about winemaking that way, where you're working with the grape, but you're also working with a palate of balance.
Yeah.
So it's an ongoing experiment year after year.
And it's a great way to adjust for those sorts of, if you want to call them, issues with a grape. You know, you take a wine that's super acidic and blend in whatever 8 or 10% Gewurztraminer that's not very acidic at all, and you've brought the acidity of the wine back down to a place that's more palatable. And we tend to blend out our concerns, but we also blend for complexity too. A lot of,
rather than adding anything artificial or anything like that,
we work with white grape varieties like Roussanne, like Viognier, Pinot Gris. A lot of those grapes, once they get the phenolic ripeness that you want, have lost a lot of their natural acidity, then can fall totally flat on the end.
Just give them a little bit of dry Riesling and then it sings.
Yeah,
you allow that to sing. Yeah.
Oh my gosh. It's so cool. I think, like, yeah, I feel like blending got a bad, I don't know when blending got a bad rep, but it feels like it's just, like, because winemaking is so many different things, right? It is very much farming. You need to farm well, you need to have good grapes, but you can have, like you said, you can farm the grapes perfectly and it's still just, like, there's something that's a little missing. And that's where, like, you bring in, like, almost like the way that you talk about it, Jayme, like, it's like the art of blending, right? You're kind of like thinking about all these things and, like, what is supposed to shine in this and what is supposed to, you know, be saying here. And I think that's fine. I think, you know, there is a little bit of a push for, like, oh, let's only let the grapes do the talking. It's like, you're still doing that.
Yeah,
you're just helping, you know, adding a few extra things, you know, I say extra things, extra grapes. They're always, you know, these different grapes in to kind of just, like you said, add complexity or kind of work with the grape. So it's an enjoyable experience. And that's your role as the winemaker.
Yes.
There are places in France like Burgundy and Alsace that are just based around single varietals. But then there's the Rhone Valley and there's Bordeaux. It's based around blends. I mean, it's not like you don't like Bordeaux. Nobody doesn't say, I don't want that Chateau Neuf to pop. I'm sorry. 13 varieties is too much in my way.
I only drink single varietal around here. Okay, well, we're talking about a lot of the wines. This is probably the hardest question that I have. But if people want to try your wines, I always like to kind of give them idea, like, which three would you recommend? You can each do a different three if you'd like as well. But which three, if they're looking on your website and they're choosing between, and this is their first time, you know, coming into Colorado wine, what should they try?
Well, we honestly agreed on the same three wines. That happens a lot. I could leave for a month and Steve would make the same wine that I would make. So we chose the same three wines, and it's the same three that we will be tasting with your club members. So that said, we wanted to talk about blending. We wanted to talk about the volatility of Colorado's climate, but how it can yield something beautiful. And also where winemaking comes into play, where you're not, you know, adding any false additives, but you're really working with the grapes that you have at hand with respect to the season at hand. And so one that we love is All the Flowers. It's a proprietary name. It's a blend that shifts from year to year. We've made All the Flowers. This will be our third vintage making it. It is aptly named because it consists of between 4 and 5 very aromatic varieties. So you really get to taste what a winemaker can do with different grapes and a different season. And this particular one that we'll be tasting and that's live on our website right now is Gewürztraminer based. And, you know, it has white Muscat, orange Muscat, and Sauvignon Blanc. But this year that we're making in tank is Viognier based. And then it's accentuated by those other varieties as well. So that's
fine. I love a wine that changes and when you just get to do those blends, because then it's just like an adventure every time. You could keep trying it every year and be like, what does it bring this year? What did they do this time?
I'm glad that you have that philosophy and imbue that with people, because people that live that want a recipe that tastes the same year after year. I mean, not only is it, it's just unattainable in so many places. Like, there's no way that we could replicate.
It's certainly unattainable here.
Yeah.
Joking aside, what's a perfect lead into this? Well, I was going to talk about the 2020 Estate Drive Riesling. Mm-hmm. 100% Riesling harvested from our vineyard just a few weeks before that crushing frost that basically destroyed Colorado's vinifera for the 2021 vintage. Mm-hmm. So Riesling is always kind of the core of what we're working on up here. We've worked with our vineyard. We manage half manage a vineyard about an hour away from here, an old vine Riesling vineyard. We've worked with other vineyards all over the state of Colorado. Riesling.
Yeah.
We can just go on forever about Riesling.
I'm curious. So you said old vine Riesling. How old are the vines that are there?
The vines in this bottle are 20 years old.
20 years old.
Yeah.
And this one's great because it's already been in bottle for 3 years. And so almost 3 years. And so it's starting to show a little more complexity in it. And the other unique thing that I'll add is that this particular wine we farmed personally. So we've done all of the pruning, all of the harvesting, all of the vineyard maintenance. So it's super special. That's my favorite out of the three, I'd say today.
Yeah. And I mean, we were talking just about this a moment ago, blending versus not blending. We've never blended a Riesling ever.
It hasn't needed it.
It's the one grape that it feels like it's the sort of like the Holy Grail almost. It's sort of untouchable in our mind, I think. We've done all sorts of iterations. Like Jayme said, our sparkling wine that we're going to release this spring is Estate Riesling. We've done medium sweet, full sweet, but dry Riesling is definitely our focus here. And it's an interesting category, dry Riesling, because it's not what people think. It's very rarely totally dry Riesling.
Yes, I learned that when there was an Oregon winemaker that I absolutely loved. He's not making wine anymore. I think it's, what was it? Something like Patris, but that's my mother-in-law's maiden name. So it's not that, but it's something like that. But he had a super dry Riesling and I tasted it. And I was glad I got to do the tasting with him because he said, this has like 10 grams of residual sugar. And I was like, no, it doesn't. This has no sugar. I can't taste any sugar.
No.
It's like people are shocked when they see what's allowed in a brut champagne at the same time. There's just so much acid you have to balance. It's just like we were talking about with the hybrid wines. We ran this fermentation in this wine totally dry, just because you want to know, but it's too dry. It feels like it's tearing the enamel off your teeth. It's super aggressive, but we had an off-dry Riesling in tank at the same time, which then people often say, how do you get sweetness in a wine? Well, blending for us is usually the way. Mm-hmm. That gives us like precise control about exactly how sweet we want the wine to be. We didn't have, in tank right now, we only have one Riesling. So for the very first year, we had to stop the fermentation at the exact perfect moment.
It was
like testing it a couple times a day, trying to get, and then we stopped it and we caught it just right, which was great, which was about the exact same as we have here, which is about 3 grams of residual sugar, about 7.5 grams of acidity, which is right about where we like to hit for a dry Riesling. Yeah.
Sweet spot. I always can't say sweet spot because it's the dry spot. But another wine, I'll kind of hit on this succinctly since we talked about, you know, hybrid, but the Rosé of St. Vincent, it's the only wine that we do differently on our label. Our labels are very identical across the board. We did that because this was the first hybrid variety we worked with. We wanted the label to stand out. We also wanted to not hide behind any perceived stigma of hybrid wine. We wanted to varietally label it. And so the first time we worked with this grape was 2019. I think this is a wonderful wine to learn about. Its parents are thought to be Pinot Noir and Chamberson. And so it has immense complexity. The acid is just bright. The fruit profile, you're just getting like that tart pomegranate, you know, a little bit of cherry plum, and this beautiful herbaceous note. And it's delicious on its own, but because of that acid profile, it's wonderful with food pairing options.
Cool. They sound wonderful. So for anybody that wants to try them, you sell them online on your website. It's stormcellarwine.com, correct?
Correct.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Want to make sure I had that. And then you do have a discount going on, so you can use the code STORMLOVE10. So the number 10 at the end, and it's 10% off any three or more bottles and a $20 flat rate shipping, which is very nice. Shipping wine is so expensive. So it's good to just have the flat rate to know right off the bat. So yeah, people can head to stormcellarwine.com and use that code STORMLOVE10 to get 10% off and $20 flat rate shipping to try the wines. I'm very excited. I'm like, they're on their way, and I'll be heading to UPS sometime today so I can pick those up. And then I also really quick just wanted you to give you a chance to talk about, you have a great wine club and then a new wine cocktail club. So you just want to talk just a little bit about that?
Yes. We're both super passionate about winemaking, obviously, and cocktails. And in a past life and in a side hustle life right now, I curate the blog Holly and Flora, and it's named after the cross streets that we lived in Denver. And wine cocktails, a lot of wineries, you know, if we could have a full bar here and do a creative bar program, that'd be great. Current liquor laws do not allow us to do that. And so finding a way to make cocktails, I know we roll our eyes too. It's a lot of laws need to be revisited.
Yes, they do.
Yes. The thing about wine cocktails, a lot of times people think is like gilding the lily. Like, why would you want to make a cocktail out of this beautiful, already balanced wine? Well, you do that with beautifully balanced bourbons, whiskeys, even scotches. Call it sacrilege. We fully embrace it. So back to that wine cocktail club, it is our first subscription model. So it'll be released so you can have 4 shipments a year. And we're still in the developmental stages of that, but it'll include 2 bottles of the same wine. It'll have 1 bottle so that you can enjoy a recipe that you can say, like, use 2 ounces of it. Or, you know, if you have a friend over, you're just using 4 ounces of that bottle. You have the ingredients to make that cocktail. And we're working with some local farms and friends to provide, like, say, you know, organic apple cider to do with like a Chardonnay cocktail, or we're working with a lavender farmer to do like a lavender honey simple syrup and honey from our valley. So not only is it a way to explore wine mixology, to learn more about the wine, there'll be a high educational component, but really approachable. You're also able to taste our valley, and you're able to taste what's in season and really take away a skill set on how to make something creative and give wine like another life, another iteration. It's a lot of, it's fun and play, but it's also serious deliciousness.
That's so fun. It reminds me too of, I recently interviewed a sommelier and wine author and now importer. But when she was a sommelier, she actually did. So like, she did it more so because she couldn't find the exact wine that she wanted. So she'd have like a wine in mind, but she's like, I need it to be like the only one she could find. I think she was in Nashville, I think, at the time. So not as big of a, you know, list of options. And so she'd, you know, she still worked with good wine to start, but it wasn't exactly what she wanted. And then she'd change it slightly by like adding in something, or like she'd rim the glass with something, or, you know, and started doing these things that, like, I think, like you said, like a lot of the wine would be like, oh my God, that's terrible. You're ruining the wine. But like, you're right. When you think about like the best cocktails, you don't use like the cheap vodka or the cheap, you know, you go for the best quality liquor. So why can't you do the same thing with wine?
Yeah, I agree.
They are a change in.
Yeah. That's another layer at our winery. We love doing wine cocktails and non-alcoholic cocktails. So it's just like, let our creativity, you know, appeal to whoever comes your way. It's exciting.
Oh, so fun. I'm so excited for that. Okay. So now let's talk a little bit, like, looking down the road. I always like to see, like, you know, what do you see for the future of the Storm Cellar and for winemaking in Colorado, you know, going like 10, 20, even 30 plus years down the road?
I think there's going to be a lot of attention focus here over that span of time. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't matter who you talk to. You talk to wine growers and climate change is real. It is. You talk to grape growers and it's undeniable, but that whatever's happening, it's shifting. Things are changing. And there are, just like we're saying, only certain ways to preserve natural acidity in grapes. Yeah. And people are talking, you know, the Napa Valley will be, you know, Sangiovese or Tempranillo country come 2050. And so you've either got to go up in latitude or up in elevation. Those are your options, really. So a lot of people think that the Rocky Mountains are poised. And water, of course, is always an issue in the in the desert. That will always be a concern. But just like Eastern Washington, the desert is an amazing place to farm if you can get water to it, because your biological threats, your pests are so far reduced. We haven't sprayed for powdery mildew in 2 years here. Mm-hmm. It's crazy. And there are vineyards in Napa Valley spraying like every week, every other week. And so people are going to try and make it work here because there are winds that can happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. As far as our personal project, you know, Steve speaking to that broader wine growing community, I think a lot of hybrids will arise, a lot of experimental styles. I love the fact that it truly is the Wild West of winemaking out here. It's kind of like that in our own winemaking facility too. We're really working with some interesting fruit like Itasca this year. It's very new hybrid to the market. And more being hybridized every year and really analyzed for quality wine. So for us, you know, we work right behind our house is our tasting room. It's all outdoor tasting room. And we're called the Storm Cellar for a reason. We have a lot of storms that kind of come through, a lot of high winds. There's never a dull moment. In our perfect world, we are ready for a roof and four walls. So a tasting room is on the horizon within the next 2 years. It's been on our horizon for a while, but, you know, 2020, 2021 with COVID, it really put a damper on our goals. So we're shifting. We've done some beautification outside, but we really want to have an option to be able to showcase food and wine in this valley. It's the organic farming capital of the state. And we work routinely with chefs. We'd love to have, you know, permanent chefs and residents at our tasting room to really do that food and wine pairing. And we've already expanded our fence line to include a wedding and events venue, and also do like two or three like casita style places for people to stay.
I was just wondering, I'm like, this sounds perfect for like a little getaway, like people can stay on the property and be right there and have, you know, all of that. Oh, it sounds lovely.
I think so too. And it really does tell that whole story of agritourism. You really, if you stay at a place, you really get to see how things are interconnected. And it's not just a show. It's not just something that you portray. It's something that you live. And so we're really excited for that. I'm thrilled.
That's a big part of what drew us to this valley. It is like untouched farm country. There's not a stoplight or a fast food restaurant for 30 minutes from here. Literally barely 1,000 people in the town we live in. And people want, just like we want, they want like the real
deal. They want an experience.
They want to be out in farm country. And when you can get that farm country experience and a world-class wine experience at the same time, that's...
And it lifts the whole valley. It grows everything.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, that sounds so fun. Let me know when those casitas are up. I'm definitely gonna make a visit. That'll be perfect. Yes. Okay, fun. I always like to end every interview. I call this the speed round, mostly because I ask you not to think too hard. Otherwise, you'll be thinking forever on these questions. So it's meant to be just top of mind, whatever comes to mind. So the first one is, what is your favorite wine at the moment? This can be a specific bottle or just a style of wine that you're reaching for a lot lately.
I get asked that question a lot. People say, what's your favorite wine? And I have a hard time choosing a favorite, but the wine I find myself reaching for out of our portfolio the most frequently lately is the Rosé of Pinot Noir that we made last year.
Yep.
It's a super cool wine, 100% Pommard clone from a 7,000 feet elevation vineyard down in Southwest Colorado. And I'm fascinated with that wine right now.
Mm-hmm. Since Steve said something about our wine, I could definitely say one too, but I'll keep it separate. There is a winery out of California, and the winery is called Amvive, and it's a couple, you know, both farm and make the wine. They make beautifully balanced, but bright, high acid, elegant, lighter style reds. They make whites too and sparkling, but I love Amvive's Gamay. And it's the only wine club that we're a member of, aside from like basically being members of our own club.
Sure.
And yeah, so
where in California is it? What region?
Oh goodness, I should know that. Los Olivos.
It's Santa Barbara.
It's Santa Barbara broadly, but specifically that's their label.
I'll have to try that. I am such a sucker for Santa Barbara wines. That area just makes such beautiful wines. They're like that perfect balance, right? And I'm definitely someone who likes a little more acidity in my wine. So that's where I go to.
Yeah.
Okay. So, I mean, speaking about region, this goes into well to our next one. What is the favorite wine region you've ever visited?
Mendoza, maybe?
Mendoza. Yeah. Okay.
I mean, the coup de grace, I went to Burgundy. Okay. But honestly, I will just blast that out of the park with the Vinho Verde region of Portugal.
Oh, I've heard really great things about Portugal.
Yes. I told Steve, I was like, if we get to retire, this is where we're going and you have no say in this. But
I can't imagine you complain too much, Steve. I mean, darn, we have to go to Portugal.
Right. Portugal for sure. Yeah.
Okay. All right. And then on the flip side, what is a wine region that you'd like to visit?
I want to go to South Africa, like Stellenbosch. And I'd also want to go to Argentina since Steve has been, and it's very similar for high elevation wine. Slovenia. I answered three, so I'm going to.
That's okay. Like I said, these are hard questions.
New Zealand.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're really fascinated with what's going on down in like the kind of Baja area of Mexico too.
We've heard such
crazy things. We've had so many wine geek friends come back there and say like, you've got to get down there.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So, that's a newer one. I've had one or two wines from Baja, but yeah, haven't heard as much about it. South Africa comes up a lot. Either it's someone's favorite region or a region they want to go to. And same with New Zealand. That is a top one. My friends just went there on a honeymoon and brought back a bottle of wine and shared it with us. And oh my gosh, like they are holding out on us. They have such incredible wines that like don't make it out of the country.
Yes. Yeah. That's the complaint.
All right. Last two questions. What is your favorite wine and food pairing? And again, it can kind of be of the moment too. You don't have to go back through all your history.
Okay. I appreciate and love off dry Riesling. So just that little hint of sweetness balanced with that acid. Maybe I won't have like a full bottle or a couple glasses, but if I have a spicy like Thai dish or like some noodle bowl that's like fiery and hot, it just brings out the fruit and the wine. That acid just works so beautiful. That's my favorite, I'd say.
Nice. Trying to think of most memorable pairing moments of the year.
It's a hard question.
We had a dinner that happened here, a big asado dinner where one of the courses was a creamed or a cheese filled agnolone and a butter sauce that we served with our Chardonnay that might have been my most memorable pairing.
I'll second that. Year. It was delicious. Just that texture pairing.
I zoned out for a couple moments while I just kind of got into that.
Yeah.
It was a special moment. Yeah, those are the best. Okay. And then last question is kind of just for those, I know some people are working on a budget, right? To drink wine, but in like some wines are better at a lower price point than others are like where you trust them. So what do you think is the best bottle of wine under $15? And again, it doesn't actually have to be like a bottle. It can be like a style, but if you've got around $15 to spend, what should you spend it on?
Where would I go? I would go Alsace. Whites from Alsace. Mm-hmm. I think you can get some really killer wines for under $15 still. Place wine, Willem and
I feel like Hugel does the, they have pretty good wines and usually pretty affordable.
Pretty affordable. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You can get Grüner Veltliner from Austria. You can get that at a good price point sometimes and really get a good expression. I mean, so many times, like we look at top 10 lists, top 15, top 20 lists of wines under a specific price point, because contrary to popular belief, we might make a luxury product, but we do not have a luxury pocketbook to spend. So we're constantly looking for those too. In our area, our small 1,000 town, person town area, we don't have a lot of options at that price point. Things are a little more expensive. So we go to the city or buy online, try to support the local economy, but at the same time, it's a balance. That said, we tend to shop more regionally. And I mean, I'll say it, a lot of times to get that, whatever that $15 price point in our area, our bang for the buck, it's not really for the wine crowd. It's like, okay, well, what is the difference? Why are we not purchasing this bottle of like $40 gin? But if you're drinking, you know, for quality, not that gin isn't quality, but if you're really drinking for quality and you're really taking your time, I would say to go to your local bottle shop and ask that buyer, say, look, I mean, there's no shame in saying, I want to spend $15 or lower. And then a lot of times those bottle shops will offer a 10% case discount. And then you can also do something really fun and ask that buyer, you know, you can't do this in big box shops. You can't do this at Costco or, you know, Total, and you're supporting someone local, but they'll be able to like assemble a case for you and you don't even know what's in it. That's one thing that we love to do. And then it sharpens your palate and you can do blind tastings by yourself. So yeah.
That's a fun idea. I've never done that before. And there's some great small wine shops around
here. Have them like pick it for you. And it's like, it's just like presents, Christmas, birthday, you know?
We've been astounded with what we found on like clearance shelves on in wine stores too. Like a white wine that might be 3 years old that's drinking beautifully right now. Yeah. That they've
or something that's not so popular that just some person put it on a discount rack because it wasn't moving because no one knew about it. We found some gems like that out here in our rural town. We're like, that is a steal. We're taking it.
We'll also go for pretty much anything sparkling at that price point, you know, Cremant de anywhere.
Yes.
Basically.
Yes. Cremant de anywhere. Or like Gruet Winery out of New Mexico, you know, they have some high tier sparkling wines, but their St. Vincent label, not to be confused with the grape, their St. Vincent sparkling many times can be right around that. Sometimes we've seen it down to $12, $15 and it's traditional method and it's exceptional for that price point.
Oh, and that was great.
Proseccos and stuff, but St. Vincent.
Yeah. Okay. Great answer. And I love that too. I love like the idea of just going to your small wine shop. I even say that for like when people are looking for affordable wine, I'm like, they don't only have expensive wine. Like almost every wine shop I've been in has a section that is literally like, here is your $10 and under or $15 and under. And those are ones you can trust that are also good. And, you know, and just like, it's always it's a great way to go. All right. Well, I almost don't want this podcast to end, but we get to talk later in the court crew. So we'll get to chat more there. But it was so great chatting with you guys and learning all about Colorado wine. And can't wait to chat more.
Yes. Thank you for your time.
Cheers.
Cheers. Thanks. I hope you enjoyed this episode of the Cork and Fizz Guide to Wine podcast. If you loved it as much as I did, I would so appreciate it if you could take a quick second, rate it, and leave a review if you haven't already. Just let people know that you enjoyed listening and maybe what was your favorite part. If you know a wine lover in your life that would enjoy this episode, please share it with them. It would mean the world to me. So I don't know if you could tell, but I am so excited to try these Colorado wines. And if you're like me, you're going to want to get yourself some Storm Cellar wine. So you're going to head to their website, stormcellarwine.com, and you can buy any of their wines that are currently available. They have a discount code for us to use, STORMLOVE10, and 10 is like the 10 not written out. So STORMLOVE10 for 10% off 3+ bottles and $20 flat rate shipping. Now, in next week's episode, we'll be doing a deep dive into Riesling. So we actually talked a little bit about Riesling in this episode, and I'm going to be doing a full deep dive into it and let you know, because I feel like it's a very misunderstood grape. Some people think of it as either being very sweet, others think of it as being very acidic, but the thing is, it can do both, and it makes really impressive wines. Thank you again for listening, and as a thank you, I'd like to share my free shopping guide, 15 Wines Under $15. Simply head to my website, corkandfizz.com, scroll down to the bottom, and join my mailing list. Cheers!